What do you think happened to Max?
Well, when I look at the photographs of Max, and I mean, I purposely did not say anything because I didn't know. And after 9 months of these experts doing a collaborative analysis, the last thing I would have wanted to hear was it was an assault and that he was, the last person's face he saw was a person that killed him. I believe the experts' reports. I believe that he was assaulted, probably more than once. And given the fracture on the top of his head, he was set down like a torpedo. So that's pretty compelling. So I do believe there was a homicide.
You know, I noticed that they're completely gutting and renovating that house there. Do you know anything about that or anything?
I have done this investigation completely on my own. It's been very hard. I don't know many people, probably don't have a forensic pathologist in your Rolodex, and neither did I. I mean, so I've done this on my own completely. I have not had interaction with Jonah, and so those questions will probably be better answered by him. We provided scientific information that disproved their biomechanical experts' report. So that's new information, because if you disprove how somebody said Max got over that railing, well, then it changes everything. Dr. Lucas personally told me at the debriefing that I asked him at the time, is there any other possibility that Max went over the banister, you know, unconscious? And he said, yes, it is possible, but I am using the biomechanical experts report, Dr. Gomez, as well as evidence of the scene, the chandelier, to create my analysis. Two things that I think are so important. Max had absolutely no dicing abrasions on his hand. He didn't have one cut, not anything, nothing. So if you grasp for a chandelier that's on the ground, not a cut, and not a cut on his body, not on his legs. So in the police diagram where they show Max next to the chandelier, he essentially would have been lying on top of this glass and there's nothing. So certainly a release of all the records to the public is probably going to be coming up very soon. Well, I can't believe I'm here looking at Coronado Bay without Max, and I can't believe I'm in this situation. I felt that it was daunting, but I am as resolved, if not more than ever. I saw some faces on the council that seemed receptive and some that were less moved. But I feel for any parent, as any person, that they deserve justice, and what's happened here is not justice. And for the community at large, I think that there should be a checks and balances system for law enforcement, as there is at the very top in the United States. This is voting time. You know, politicians are out there, and I thought that the United States was really based on this idea of free speech and of checks and balances, and I think it becomes a little unusual when you clearly present information that scientifically disproves what a police department has come up with, and people can say, too bad, we're sticking with our brand of physics. But do we accept that as citizens? Should we?
So where do you go, to the state attorney general's office, or where do you go from here?
Well, I think that the state attorney general's is certainly a possibility, but I believe that there are other agencies that can step back and look at actually this entire labyrinth of relationships, because I think that there's something there that I don't quite understand. Because with the facts that we've presented, which is what they said, that, as you know, science doesn't lie, and it's true, real science doesn't lie. So with what we've presented, there is absolutely no reason not to reopen this case and amend the disposition and find out what happened. As far as we know, there were two people that the Coronado Police Department say that were there, but how do we know that? I mean, how do we know there's not another person? And how do we know that person's not out and about? I mean, isn't it a public safety issue and an issue of integrity for law enforcement, as well as finding the truth and justice for a six-year-old little boy who was definitely the victim of a homicide? At some point, they wrote me letters saying that this was going to be a seamless investigation. They were going to be sharing the data. And then all of a sudden it was, you know, referred back to Coronado Police Department. There was pieces of data that were not included in Max's file that, according to Commander Lawton, would typically have been included in Max's file. So that's kind of one of those policy procedure political things I don't understand. Last week, I spoke to Sheriff Gore, and I asked him many of the questions that I'm sharing with you. And I don't know that he was aware that the district attorney's office prepared the diagram. And I told him that I thought he should be aware because he presented it nationally. So he said he would speak to Chief Scanlon. And I asked if he would please call me back. But we had a pretty extensive conversation. I asked why certain of the records weren't included in Max's file. He didn't know, but he would talk to Chief Scanlon and Commander Lawton and Jonathan Lucas. So I'm waiting for a call, but I won't be sitting by the phone holding my breath. I certainly will be calling back again and again because I'm not going away. And that's the point. I'm not going away.
What do you think happened to Rebecca, and do you think her family should reopen that case?
I don't have any of the records of Rebecca's death, but I would say this. If their family has gone through what I've gone through, and there have been discrepancies like I have seen, then I believe, if that's the case with them, then I believe that both families who have questions that linger deserve to have their questions answered, no doubt. I know how it feels to lose a son, and they've lost a sister and a daughter. So we did everything that they asked of us. So that is why I was shocked after jumping through the hoops, doing what we were meant to do, crossing the T's, dotting the I's, that the response was, we're gonna, you know, essentially believe our own brand of physics.
Did they ask questions?
But their photographs, essentially that when the injuries on Max's back really match, the pattern matches the banister. And Dr. Robert Bove was allowed access last October, so he has actual photographs of the banister. And Max's back had sustained injuries. There were abrasions. The skin had been scraped off. And that pattern matched the pattern of the actual banister. In fact, when we went to the evidence locker, I saw his T-shirt. And when I looked at the inside, there was something, some kind of material, and it, I think, was probably dried skin. So I don't know why they never followed up on that. There is also evidence missing from the evidence locker in San Diego. This was one of the things I discussed with Sheriff Gore. I know that when we went to the evidence locker, you have to put your gloves on, you stand away. I mean, there's a protocol that's strictly adhered to. So I don't understand why they have photographs of certain things and they're missing now. They're just missing. That doesn't make sense to me. There's a link where the chandelier was disattached and now it's just missing. And there's no explanation why. There's a photograph of it, it's taken into evidence, and now it's not there. So when I initially asked, they didn't have an answer for me. They thought somebody else had checked it out. But the answer over time was, well, I guess, you know, we can't find it. That's another thing that's concerning to me. How does that happen? How does that piece of evidence disappear? With all of this attention to this case, why is there a missing piece? That doesn't make sense. I would also say that there were many things done that were not done with Max. I never received any results from any DNA that they said that they took from him. There was no results of DNA. Many things that were just simply not done. So these are all things that, for me, I have no experience, again, with media, with law enforcement, with how this works, but it seems like something's not adding up.
Are you going to be appearing with the Zaha family later this week on a national television show?
I have. We are both on. We're not together on stage, but we are both. We both presented and we both spoke to Dr. Phil. Yes, I believe it will be on Friday. Yes.
Okay. And what did you feel about that experience?
I thought it was daunting and very scary. If someone would have asked me a year ago, would you be standing in front of cameras or going on a show and talking about this, I would have said, you know, this has been one of the hardest things. Other than, well, obviously losing Max was the hardest thing in my entire life. He's irreplaceable. Talking about it publicly has been very, very hard. And the reason I'm doing it is to find justice for him and for other children. We have started maxieshouse.org. It is not involved with the investigation. It is simply a nonprofit that I have funded, and we have gotten great support from the community to help other children and uphold and promote the safety of children in blended families. So that is something that, in Max's honor, that will help the resolution for me, and we can help other children. And I know if Maxie was here, he would say, Mommy, you should do that. You should help other kids. I know he would tell me that. And so definitely that's part of this. We also do have maxshacknai.com, and that's just for people to get information. Look for themselves at the report. Look at Dr. Gomez report, which is 5 pages. Look at our expert's report, which is 29 pages. Just people can look for themselves. And then we have created an online petition. And with all the, as well as information of all the officials here, so that they can write a letter, they can sign a petition, they can make their own voices known. And we really hope through Maxie and through Maxie's house that we can inspire people to be the voice of Max and the voice of children. And to help children, not just Max, but all children in every state.
What would you like to say to the people of Coronado here, the folks here?
I would like to say, first of all, thank you for taking an interest in Maxie's story. And he loved being here. He loved the people here. He had the best times of his life here. So, and this place was magical for him. And I would also ask, please, please, to look on maxshacknai.com, evaluate the information that we have provided. Please sign a petition to reopen the case. Call or contact the local officials, and please, please help Max find justice. And in doing that, we can really move forward and then help other children so that this doesn't happen to them. And I would also ask that please don't assume this could never happen to you or your children or your child, because it can, and it did to me, and we can prevent that. So my plea is, please take an interest and communicate to those people here that might help to reopen this case.
What are you hoping to accomplish with the City Council today?
I'm hoping to provide them the information in a format, a prepared format, so that they have everything, and then they can really review the case and hopefully encourage the influencers and the police to really take another look at this investigation, a real look. I don't believe, as stewards of the community, they can do that. So I trust that they will do the right thing. Thank you, everyone. Wish me luck.
Department of Environmental Health to regulate mobile food facilities operating in Coronado utilizing the standard letter grading system on page 75. There are no other items currently proposed for the consent calendar. Are there any items that members of the council would like removed for discussion?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. No, there's none asked to be added or removed.
Thank you. Any other council members wish to remove?
And it says it's been established as an endowment, and I don't recall establishing an endowment, so at some time they could bring it back to just show us. It was an endowment when it came to us, but I don't think we established an endowment, so I just want to make sure that's clarified for the public.
All right. Are you comfortable with the
I'm comfortable with approving it. I think what's on our agenda is fine, but I think that should be clarified.
Thank you. Mr. Mayor and Mr. King and members of the City Council and the community members, thank you for allowing me to speak today. My name is Dina Shacknai, and I am a citizen and homeowner in this community. And I'm here to be the voice of my only son, Maxie Shacknai, who can no longer speak for himself. My six-year-old son, Max, died right here in this town on July 16, 2011. Our last 4th of July together was right here in this town. The last time I kissed him goodnight was right here in this town. In fact, every birthday he ever had was celebrated in this town. The last time he told me he loved me was right here in this town. Max and I loved every moment we spent in Coronado, the beautiful beaches, our picnics at sunset, the Moontime Creamery, the Spreckels candy shops were family favorites. It was family time, a time that he and I made beautiful with lasting memories. Those beautiful memories seem far away from me now, as they have been replaced by the memories of the circumstances surrounding the death and subsequent actions of the Coronado Police Department, which have led me to this podium this afternoon. I'm here because, as a mom and scientist, I couldn't make sense of the version of the incident provided to me by the Coronado Police Department. I'm here because I had hoped that truth would outweigh political expediency, and the professional law enforcement personnel of the city would reopen the death investigation of Max after they were presented with the compelling findings of nationally accredited experts who are affiliated with the most prestigious organizations in the country. At the very least, I expected that during the COPD's review process, they would consult Dr. Mark Gomez, their own independent biomechanical expert whose distorted diagram, prepared by somebody at the DA's office, served as the linchpin of the ME's decision to rule Max's death an accident. After an exhaustive 9-month investigation and a meticulous collaborative analysis by independent experts, who I retained, Drs. Bove and Melnick, they undeniably refute the accident scenario presented by the Coronado Police Department and Dr. Jonathan Lucas at the ME's office. In fact, Drs. Bove and Melnick concluded that Max could not have gone over the banister with 1 foot, 2 feet, with a dog, with a ball, or with a scooter. Each scenario defies the laws of gravity and physics. Further, Max's injuries were not consistent with an accident scenario given the multiple planes of injury and locations of those injuries. Both experts agreed that Max, my 6-year-old son, was the victim of an assault scenario which culminated in a homicide, the most horrific scenario a parent could ever hear. As a mother of a beautiful 6-year-old child who loved Coronado, the beach, his family, his soccer buddies, his sweetie of 2 years, and his wife, I'm asking that this council personally review the information I provide to each of you. As the mother of a dead child, I believe he deserves more than a 3-sentence note declining my request to reopen the reinvestigation. It pains me to think how Max would feel and what he would say if he knew that the investigation into his death was handled in such a dismissive manner.
Ms. Shacknai, I'm going to have to ask you to summarize, please.
Sure. I know the police have many cases. I have one case, and I promise and give my commitment to the community that I will leave no stone unturned to find out what happened to Max, wherever that leads me. But I would say that the response I've received from the Coronado Police Department has generated more questions than when I started. And I encourage you to please review the information, and if you feel justified, look at maxshacknai.com. Signed a petition to reopen this case, and I would say, just as people work to build a strong foundation for the Coronado Bridge, so law enforcement should be accountable for building and maintaining a strong foundation for everyone, for safety in this community, for Max, for all of you, and for all of the community at large. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
After the efforts and their seeming receptivity, that it was so dismissive, I was incredulous and demoralized, shocked, and I thought to myself, my little son, any little child, any of us, deserve justice and more than a 3-line note saying, sorry, we're not looking into it. So I was devastated, but not finished by a long shot. The toughest thing that has ever happened to me, and losing Max, this is the bad thing. Losing Maxie was an indescribable nightmare. He was, for me, a treasure. And I've said before, his Hebrew name is Matan, and it means the gift. And he was a gift for me. So even being Coronado today reminds me of all the wonderful times we've had here. He celebrated every birthday here. He loves the Mutine Creamery and the Spreckels candy shop. So it's very hard to be here and to think of what happened to him. And I am imploring the community, the police, to please do the right thing, reopen this case, and adjust the disposition as science has shown. Because when I started this process, the last thing I wanted to hear, the last thing I thought was that there was an assault scenario followed by a homicide. For any mother, that's the worst outcome. So we've had the benefit of 9 months. The Coronado Police Department had 7 weeks. Well, we've done our homework. Drs. Bove and Melnick, their reputations and their credentials are impeccable. So we put it on the website, maxshacknai.com. People I'm encouraging them, read the data for yourselves, everyone, and please, you know, if you believe in this, please sign the petition. And Max got along with everybody. Maxie was, and by all accounts, the pictures that you probably have seen of him, and the picture of him smiling, this isn't just an instance, this is every single day. I used to wake up and I'd see him in the morning and I'd look down and his face, he'd have this smile on his face every morning, and I would think to myself, I've said this before, I won the lottery. I mean, I just would feel like jumping up and down saying, oh my gosh, this boy is amazing. We were a perfect fit. Maxie was the most amazing boy, generous and funny and wise and shrewd and loving. And he was the littlest guy in a soccer team. He played up. He was a five-year-old playing against 6 and 7-year-olds. And I admired his courage to go out there every time with kids that were a head taller than him and go out there and play his hardest. And the only thing that the coach would say was, Max, it's okay to be a little more aggressive. And Max would say, but Mommy, I'm playing with my friends. So, and I would say also that sometimes he would say to me, Mommy, can we just talk? Can you and I just talk? And I thought to myself, I am the luckiest mommy that ever lived in all the universes because I have you, Maxie.